Wow, we'll see where that's going to go. Come on in. Hello. Welcome. Good to see you. Well, he is risen indeed. If this is true, if what Matthew says here in his gospel account, that Jesus has risen from the dead, if this is true, surely nothing is more important, nothing is more urgent, nothing is more significant for us than believing it and following this risen Christ. Because if you believe that he has indeed risen, then you will believe what he says a few verses later in Matthew 28. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given me. This is Jesus' words. Which of these two things do you think is easier to believe? Which is easier to believe, that Jesus has risen from the dead, or that all authority, command, dominion, supremacy over everything? Think about this. Over all governments, politics, over all military might, over industry, commerce, science, education, over all aspects of the media, over the natural phenomena, including our lives, our health, our death. What's easier to believe? And what does it mean for those of us who do believe that he has risen from the dead and that he has been given this authority? And I know for many here, if not most, it's not an if. It's not an if that's true. But it is true. And you don't only believe, but you live by it. And so today is the great celebration, not just of an event recorded in human history, the most significant event recorded in human history, but it's a celebration of faith, of your faith in our faithful God. But some here today or listening online, these statements, these testimonies of Jesus may not be true. They may be an if still in your hearts and your minds. Or people may have decided they're not true. They may have decided that Jesus didn't rise from the dead, or he hasn't been given all authority in heaven and on earth for a whole variety of reasons. But I hope that you can appreciate, for those of us who do believe, this is in fact the most important, the most urgent, the most critical, the most defining event in our lives. And so I hope also that you can appreciate that this event deserves your attention. This event deserves your attention of all of us, and that you will not dismiss what you hear today, but will consider what you hear on Easter Sunday, Resurrection Sunday 2021. Our habit here is to read a psalm, and we're going to read Psalm 2 this morning, and we're going to read that right now. Why do the nations rage and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth set themselves and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, let us burst their bonds apart and cast away their cords from us. He who sits in the heavenly heavens laughs. The Lord holds them in derision. Then he will speak to them in his wrath and terrify them in his fury, saying, as for me, I have set my king on Zion, my holy hill. I will tell of the decree. The Lord said to me, you are my son. Today I have begotten you. Ask of me, and I will make the nations your heritage and the ends of the earth your possession. You shall break them with a rod of iron and dash them in pieces like a potter's vessel. Now therefore, O kings, be wise. Be warned, O rulers of the earth. Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling. Kiss the Son, lest he be angry and you perish in the way, for his wrath is quickly kindled. Blessed are those who take refuge in him. Please pray with me this morning. Father, what a solemn reminder from this psalm of the plight of this world who have decided not to acknowledge Jesus as the risen Savior, as the risen Lord. But Father God, we thank you that as we come together this morning, we do take refuge in you, and we are indeed blessed that you have given us faith to believe, not just in an event, not just in something that happened in history, but to have faith in a risen Savior who has rescued us from our plight, rescued us from the dominion of darkness, rescued us from the sin that would hold us down and keep us from you. We thank you for Jesus. We thank you for his death. We thank you for his resurrection. And we thank you for life in him through his Spirit. And we pray this morning that our hearts, our worship, our voices would be lifted as one in recognition of who you are. And so we pray your blessing on all that we say, all that we do in this fellowship. And we pray that it indeed fills your heart with joy to see your people meeting to celebrate this way this morning. Thank you for the number of people who are here, who for the friends that we haven't seen perhaps for quite some time, just to look around now and to enjoy this experience this morning. We give you thanks for all your mercy to us, all your blessings, and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. We are going to sing A Glorious Day, and there's a sadness to this morning's music. Today will be the last day that we hear from Sam and Jordan. Jordan, when you move away, and that means you can't keep coming along to your local church, but he'll find another church, I'm sure, and Sam needs to take a break due to his commitments. And so this is the last time that they'll be playing together with us this morning. So let's sing out nice and loud and enjoy their ministry to us. Thank you very much, guys. Thank you.
Far away, rising. When Lee was speaking earlier, there seemed to be an echo. Is that still present while I'm speaking? Oh, good. Okay. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, we're so thankful for another Easter time. The time when we can turn our attention and wonder to the climax of your life on earth, your time on earth. We're overwhelmed with wonder and praise, Lord Jesus, that in line with God's plan from before time began, you came into the world you created as a man, lived the perfect life of obedience, and then was crucified at the hands of evil men and women. They crucified the Lord of glory, the spotless Lamb of God who takes away our sins. But thanks be to our Father God that death could not conquer your perfect life. Instead, you rose in triumph and conquered death in a miracle of God's grace. And now by faith in your name, we can share the benefits of your victory over sin and death. Because of your obedience to the Father's will, all authority is yours in heaven and earth, Lord Jesus. We agree with your right to rule in our lives and over everything. And so, Lord Jesus, we want to carry out your instruction to go empowered by your Spirit and make disciples here in Doonside, in the great city of Blacktown, elsewhere in Australia, and indeed anywhere else that you may send us. Please help us to commit ourselves to this every day, to share the wonderful news of a Saviour who forgives sins and reconciles people to himself for all time. Give us the courage and readiness to share this news everywhere you place us in your world, in our homes, to our family, our friends and neighbours, our workmates and beyond. And as your Spirit enables members of our families and our friends to come to you and be saved, may we in our church have the joy of seeing many of them being baptised into the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord, for the freedom we enjoy in Australia to share this good news. And thank you, too, that in your mercy, the COVID epidemic has been controlled here to the extent that many of the limitations on our meeting together to worship have been lifted. We pray for our leaders and medical staff to continue to act wisely so that the virus may be completely defeated. And we ask this for all the peoples of the world. Have mercy, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for the parting promise of Jesus to be with us always till the end of the age. While we wait for his return in glory and great power, bind us together in unity so that the world may know that Jesus still lives with his people. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. Amen. I'm going to read Matthew 28. The resurrection. Now, after the Sabbath, toward the dawn of the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothing white as snow. And and for fear of him, the guards trembled and became like dead men. But the angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has risen, as he said. Come, see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead. And he's going before you to Galilee. There you will see him. See, I've told you." So they departed quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy and ran to tell his disciples. And Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came up and took hold of his feet and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there they will see me." The report of the guard. While they were going, some of the guard went into the city and told the chief priests all that had taken place. And when they had assembled with the elders and taken counsel, they gave a sufficient sum of money to the soldiers and said, "Tell people his disciples came by night and stole him away while we were asleep. And if this comes to the governor's ears, we'll satisfy him and keep you out of trouble." So they took the money and did as they were directed. And this story has been spread among the Jews to this day. The Great Commission. Now, the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks very much, Alan. We're going to sing again in a moment, but I have a few announcements just to fill in regulars at Westview what's happening, but also it's great to welcome people here, some perhaps for the first time. Sue and Nellie at the back there are here. They're friends of Sherry's, and it's great to have you here. And it is great to have some much-loved friends back with us this morning, and what a real surprise to see you, mate. It's fabulous to see you. We'll catch up with you later on. This morning, that's who I was sort of mentioning. We will be sharing communion a little later on, and perhaps those of you who don't regularly meet with us, you may not be familiar with this. We did talk about this on Good Friday. This is how we serve communion here. There's just a little thing you lift up the top here, take the wafer to eat, and then underneath there's a small cup with the juice. Might be a little tricky to get used to, but you'll get there in the end. Just a reminder too that the small wafer is not gluten-free, if that's something that you need to be aware of. Next Sunday morning after our service is our third discussion group around the New Church Paradigm series that we concluded in January. Thanks very much to everyone who has contributed so much to this ongoing discussion. Next Sunday will be the next one of those, so we'll be hoping to continue that after our time together. Please pray about being a participant in that. Next term, on the 25th of April, will be our very first community prayer night for 12 months. So we're getting back into our community prayer night once a month. It's the fourth Sunday in the month, so Sunday night, the 25th of April. I know that's Anzac Day. It's an Anzac Day weekend. But if we don't have it then, we've got to wait till May. We're not waiting. So we're going to have it on the 25th. If you can make it, fantastic. Just something I have to mention administratively. We've had a letter from council. There's a proposed development happening on the house on the other side of the roundabout, directly diagonal from us. They're going to knock that house down and build two, of course, which is the way of things these days. If you want to see that, it's on the table. If you want to make representation or you want us to on your behalf, please let me know so we can get that in on time. Lastly, after the school holidays, so over the next couple of weeks, we have Alan and Timothy who are going to preach. We're moving into our new Bible teaching series, which will be around the wonderful, eccentric book of Jonah. If we haven't looked at Jonah for a while, but looking forward to Jonah. So if you want to start having a read through Jonah, please do that in preparation for our next teaching series together. We're going to sing again. We're going to sing Mighty to Save. Thanks very much, guys. Thank you.
Please stand and join us.
Thanks very much. Now, there is Sunday school this morning. So for those who have children who are of Sunday school age, that's up to the end of primary, happy for you to head out to Sunday school with Becky. If you're new and haven't attended Sunday school before, we might need you to just fill in a little form, which is available. But if you're a regular, that's fine. We have your details. And just while we're letting them go to Sunday school, just a very quick reminder, we really do need you to make sure you sign in using the QR code if you can. If you can't, if you could just jot your details down, we need your name and a contact phone number, just so we know who was here on this morning. Anyway, that's more administration. Let's pray before we look into God's word together, shall we? Father, it's great to be able to say Sunday school is on, and for our young ones to head out and to hear truth from your word told in stories in ways that will stay with them. And we pray that these things will build a great foundation in their life as many of us look back and are thankful for those who taught us Sunday school, scripture, great truths that we cling to and hold on to now. And as we read this morning of this marvelous event of the risen Christ, we pray that once again you would renew us in our spirit, renew our faith, renew our confidence in you, and fill us, Father God, with that awe that leads to worship and fruitful living. For your sake we pray. Amen. Christians, of course, regard the resurrection of Jesus from the dead as the defining event, not just in human history, but of course of our faith. From the resurrection flows everything, everything, our beliefs, our mission, our purpose, our hope. The Apostle Paul, writing to the church in Rome, said in chapter 4, "It will be counted to us who believe in him who raised from the dead our Lord, who was delivered for our trespasses and raised for our justification." What will be counted for us? Righteousness, rightness before God, the elimination of sin, which prevents us from enjoying that righteousness, is what Jesus has achieved through his death and his resurrection. To the Corinthians, Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 15:14, "And if Christ had not been raised, then our preaching is in vain and your faith is in vain." And that's the truth. If he'd stayed in the grave, what would be the point? If there is no resurrection, then we are what? A community of believers in a dead leader? We know better than any other religion. But we are better, not because we are better people. We are better because we have a risen Savior who has died and risen and gone to be with his Father to allow us to continue in our faith. Paul continues in his letter to the Corinthians that if there is no resurrection and we continue in our faith, we are to be pitied, he said. We're to be pitied. People laugh at us for this. And rightly so, because what's the point of doing what we do for the sake of a dead leader? Of course, no human actually witnessed the resurrection of Jesus. Nobody actually saw that take place. People met the resurrected Jesus, some of them very soon after that event, and many others over a 40-day period leading up to Jesus' return to his Father. These people witnessed the risen Savior. It's a bit of a summary here of those who met him in as close an order as I could work out from the four gospel accounts and from Paul's writing. I could be wrong, but you know, this is pretty much as I kind of figured things out. So first, in a very unusual and remarkable departure from what people might have expected, and Jesus was very much want to do this sort of thing, the first people he met were women. He met Mary and the other Mary and some of the other women who had witnessed him being buried. Then at some point he meets Peter and sees him. And then his next encounter was with the two on the road to Emmaus. Then he appears to 10 of the disciples in the upper room in Jerusalem, and then again to them, plus Thomas, who wasn't there on that first occasion. After this, he arrives by the Sea of Tiberias and he eats with 7 of the disciples. And then we have Paul's testimony that he appeared to over 500 people at some point. 500 people altogether, 500 people, not exactly clear. 500 people witnessed him. Then he meets James, and then as Matthew records in chapter 28, as we read this morning, the 11 remaining disciples before returning to glory, and finally, on the road to Damascus, he confronts Paul. None of this proves anything in itself. They are not evidence of the resurrection in themselves, except all of these people met the risen Jesus. It adds weight, doesn't it? It adds weight to this actually having happened. These people meeting Jesus, so many different places, having their stories recorded by many different people, it makes all the conspiracies and collusions and intrigue much less credible, I think. Before the resurrection, of course, was the crucifixion, which we remembered on Friday, and let me remind you of the huge significance of that through the Apostle Peter in his first letter. This is 1 Peter 1:18 and 19. Knowing that you were ransomed for the futile ways inherited from your forefathers, not with perishable things such as silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without blemish or spot. Sometimes we read these verses and we do get the big idea, but just focus for a moment on that word precious. The blood of Jesus, precious blood poured out for us to allow us to be free from sin. The crucifixion, the horrific death of Christ, precious to those who believe, because it's how we are ransomed from sin and guilt and condemnation, and how we are given that eternal life in Christ. But the value of the crucifixion, to use a modern term, is increased beyond measure, of course, by the resurrection. It is in fact worthless if Jesus remained dead. So what should we say about the resurrection? Firstly, it was powerful. It was a powerful event. Now, power can be displayed in many different ways. People perceiving something to be powerful in many different ways. Matthew's account of the resurrection is brief, to say the least, compared to perhaps some of the other Gospels. But his account starts very early in the morning with a group of women anxious to get to the tomb to complete the proper burial rites. They probably started when Jesus was placed in the grave, which had to be cut short due to the Sabbath. Mark tells us that this group of women was actually discussing how they would gain access to the tomb, having witnessed the huge stone being rolled across the entrance to the cave. The power of the resurrection is displayed in what happened before the women even arrived at the tomb. 28 verses 1 to 3. Now, after the Sabbath, towards the dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to see the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning and his clothing white as snow. God intervenes in this powerful way, even in the detail of removing the stone, which, of course, we know wasn't removed to let Jesus out. It was removed to let people in. Matthew only mentions that they were overcome with two emotions, fear and joy. But you can imagine these other emotions that were swirling around as they were confronted with the appearance of an angel of God who shone, who it seemed like didn't reflect light. Light shone from him. It was like lightning, it says. Well, I can imagine their emotions were a little bit more than just fear and joy when they saw that. Fear, joy, amazement, confusion. None of these things inhibit the angel from passing to these women a message, a mission, giving them a purpose. Go quickly and tell the disciples that he is risen and that he will go to Galilee and see them there. You can almost see them backing away, can't you? Yeah, you see that in movies, people backing away, and then they turn to flee back as quickly as they can to the city to find the disciples to pass on this stupendous news. And while Matthew doesn't record this, as they turn to go, almost stumbling over Jesus, who's standing right there. Matthew simply states the reaction of the women when they realize who it is that it's speaking to them. So they departed quickly from the tomb for fear with great joy. They ran to tell the disciples, and behold, Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came up and took hold of his feet and worshipped him. Again, a simple message, a simple sentence. But what's caught up in all of that? How did they worship him? Still in awe, wonder, confusion, fear, joy, they fall at the feet of the risen Lord and worship him. When was the last time that the awe, the wonder, the joy, or the fear of remembering who Jesus is caused us, caused you, caused me to fall at his feet and worship him? When was the last time that happened? Who did they worship? Surely not the same Jesus they witnessed being put into the grave, and yet it was the same man that they knew from the time they had spent with him traveling around Palestine. In John 20, Jesus reveals who he is in the way he recognizes Mary by saying her name, and in doing that, the emotion of joy overwhelms those other emotions that had filled their minds, the minds of these women, and they start to realize what is happening. If not the full significance, things are starting to become a little bit more concrete for them. We can't prove the resurrection, but belief in it is, of course, central to our faith. The testimony of this group of people who encountered Jesus in the days after his death teaches us many things. In particular, I think it describes to us a physical resurrection of a man. He's not a spirit. He's not a ghost of some kind or another. The significance of this is that the resurrection of Jesus was a bodily resurrection, as will ours be on that great day when Jesus' kingdom is finally revealed in all of its glory. As powerful as his resurrection is, it's also very personal. And just as some were overcome with emotions like joy, others conspired to reject the truth of it. Not just the resurrection of Jesus, but the resurrection of Jesus as Lord. The Sanhedrin, the ruling religious council of the Jewish people who pursued Jesus to the cross, now wanted to keep him in the grave. The problem was, of course, the grave is empty. He's not in the tomb. It would not have taken long for news of the vanishing body to filter into the community. In fact, a fact reported truthfully by the guards set to prevent this event from actually happening. These days we would call it spin, wouldn't we? As these ruling Jewish leaders come up with their plan to stop the truth from getting out into Jerusalem and beyond. But just as they were powerless to prevent the stone from being rolled away and to prevent the resurrection itself, so too they were powerless to prevent the good news from being shared in Jerusalem, Samaria, and even to the ends of the earth. There's some discussion amongst commentators about the implausibility of this part of the story happening, the guards accepting this huge bribe to keep quiet when if they were found out, they were certain to be put to death for having failed in their duty to stay awake when it was their job to do that. But I think even the implausibility makes this whole story more likely, more believable, when you see this small part of the picture in the context of the rejection of Jesus by the religious leaders of the day. Verse 15 of Matthew 28 concludes that this is in fact what happened, and it signifies a severing, a breaking between the fledgling early church and the Jewish authorities, if that hadn't already happened because of these events. The two could not be compatible. They could not live together. And while it was hundreds of years before there was an official breaking of that connection by people in secular authority, there's no doubt at that point there was a severing between those two groups. While there are many details around the women fulfilling their mission, the task given to them by the angel to tell the disciples what had happened, they did do that. And Matthew records that the disciples do indeed journey to Galilee to meet up with Jesus. What were they thinking as they were doing that? I mean, they'd already decided to believe these women and they were going on this journey to meet up with Jesus. Imagine the discussions going on during that trip. The questions by some, those who were more confident, perhaps more defined in their statements. Perhaps there were others who were just quietly contemplating all that was happening to make sense of what was going on. And then they see him, probably not for the first time, but they see the risen Lord of glory, and they too are overcome with emotion, and they worship him, even, we are told, by those who doubted. Isn't that a strange paradox? People who see the risen Jesus still doubting, but they have to worship him. They're compelled to worship him. They're compelled to fall at his feet. Just like those disciples, this is the point everyone comes to in the resurrection story, isn't it? Everyone comes to this point in the resurrection story. Do you believe it happened? And so then, does that truth give birth to worship and fruitful living? Or do you allow doubts or even complete rejection of this defining moment to influence you to live without accepting that Jesus rose from the dead and all that the Bible teaches that follows on from that belief? This is the point we all come down to. The chief priests and the elders of the Jewish religious council took this line. But why did they do that? They had the advantage of great knowledge of the scriptures. They'd studied meticulously. They knew the plan of God was to send his messenger, his Messiah, to save not only his people, but all humankind. Why didn't they see in Jesus that person? Why didn't they see that in Jesus Christ? I think the answer is found in what Jesus said to the women when they encountered him. "Don't be afraid," he said. "Don't be afraid." These people were afraid. They were afraid they would lose control, they would lose power, lose influence, as well as their privileged positions. And I think we ask people the same question today, don't we? Why do some people simply reject the message of the gospel without even considering or listening to it? I think it's because they're afraid. I think they're afraid of what belief will entail for them. It will mean giving up that control. It will mean giving up your life. It will mean giving up being your own God and recognizing Jesus as that God. And it's too much for some people. And there's a huge sadness in that, a huge sadness, especially when we sit here this morning, most of us, many of us here, having accepted Jesus as Lord, and the joy that that brings, and the freedom it brings, and the things that we enjoy because of that belief. How to convince people of that? How to let... That's the job of the Holy Spirit. Pray for those people. Pray for them. They are afraid of the consequences of believing. But ironically, if they did listen, fear is one of those things that they would be relieved of in their belief. When Jesus does meet his disciples on that mountain in Galilee before he returns to his Father in heaven, he tells them why they have no need to fear. Because, he says, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me." Not to the church, not to church leaders, not to elders and deacons, but to Christ alone, who works out his saving purposes in the world. His cause, his purposes and plans cannot fail if you have all authority and power. If you cannot die, you are going to prevail in all that you do. Jesus cannot die. He will prevail in all of his purposes and plans. No one else has held that authority in history ever. Not even the most brilliant general, king, leader, ruler, conqueror. No one except Christ. And so we believe he is with us always to the end of all things here on earth. And we teach others to obey his commands. As we recently read in John's letter, this is how we learn how to love one another, to love others. This is why Jesus left his Father's glory, came to earth, suffered the agony and the humiliation of the cross, went into the grave and to hell, and then rose again from the dead with all authority given to him in heaven and on earth to build his kingdom of people free from fear and the power of sin, whose hearts urge them to worship and fruitful living to the praise of his glory. Is that your place today? Is that your story today? Is that what you believe and know and live out in your life? If it is, amen. If it's not, today is the day of salvation. Today is the day of God's mercy to you, because there is still that time to make this your place in life. And so I would urge you, I would encourage you to listen, to read this story, to read this account, to forget what you hear in the world. Oh, it couldn't possibly happen. It's not possible. Of course it's not possible. But we're talking about God. We're talking about the power of God. And so take that on board. Think about it. Talk to someone about it. Talk to us about it. Get in touch with a friend. Find out how this impacts you for eternity. This is not just for Easter 2021. This is an eternal decision that you make today. By not making the decision, you make that decision for eternity. Let me pray. Father, while we do rejoice in the huge significance of this resurrection day, we do remember those who we know who haven't been able to bring themselves to believe. And there's a sadness for each of us as we think of others we know who are in that position. We pray for them right now. There may even be a name on your heart that you want to pray for that person right now, that somehow the Spirit of God would get through to them on this Easter Sunday 2021. Pray for that person right now. But Father, we ask you in your mercy to be merciful to those who are outside of your kingdom, somehow through your Spirit, through the testimony of someone they know, that they would hear the gospel and respond. Thank you, Father God, for the truth of your word. Thank you for the way that it has entered our hearts and our minds and led each of us to worship and fruitful living. And for some, Father God, it's difficult. They live with things that prevent them from doing much of what they would like to do. We pray, Father God, that you would encourage them in their spirit as they seek to live fruitful lives for you. For our young people, Father God, who are going to live in a world that is going to be very different to what even we knew 20, 30 years ago, we pray that you would give them strength, courage that they're going to need going forward as we wait for your return. So, Father, we thank you for this message this morning of hope in you that is still so relevant after all of these years. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing our final song and then there will be a final blessing. No, there won't. There's going to be communion. Thanks, Sue. I have got it written right here. I have. We share the communion meal each week here at Westview. But this morning, of course, it takes on such a different significance because it is Resurrection Sunday. And so as you take these small little cups with this strange little contraption on top here, let's not be distracted by that for a moment. Let's remember why we do this. Because he is risen. Because he did go to the cross and he died. He was placed in the tomb. But he is risen. And for us who believe, this is a reminder of that. This is going to take a minute or two. We haven't had to hand out so many for a long time. It's great. So please just take a moment to open that up, get that small wafer. We have heaps more if people haven't got one. Everybody right? Thanks. Thanks, Janelle. I think we're good. Thank you. Let's eat together and remember Jesus. In the same way also, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Let's drink together. Father God, we are reminded in your word to examine ourselves and to think about our lives as we share this meal, and as we've eaten a small wafer, as we've drunk a small amount of juice, we do now come to you and confess to you those things that we've done, said and thought that were unworthy of being a follower of Jesus. And we ask for your forgiveness, and we thank you for your forgiveness for those sins that we have confessed. We thank you that that doesn't stop us from enjoying our fellowship with you and with our brothers and sisters in Christ. But we thank you that this small meal is a symbol of what it cost you to allow that to happen. And so we give you thanks for this meal in Jesus' name. Amen. We are now going to sing our final song as we collect these little cups. And then there will be a final blessing in our time together this morning. Thanks, guys.
Would you like to stand and as we sing our last song?
Thank you.
come together, they asked him, "Lord, will you at this time restore them a kingdom of Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth." And when he had said these things, as they were looking on, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. And while they were gazing into heaven as he went, behold, two men stood by them in white robes and said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into heaven? This Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. Surely I am coming soon." Amen?
Amen.
Come, Lord Jesus, and the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Amen. Thank you for being with us this morning. God bless you this week. Thank you.